Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, for this is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Amen.
We'd like to thank each and every one of you that has come out for our morning worship service. Amen.
Amen.
And we invite each and every one of you to join in during our devotional period. Amen.
Amen.
And at this time, those that can stand, please stand for the reading of God's word.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Our scripture reading will be coming from Psalm 37, chapter starting at the 23rd verse, which says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. I have been young and now more, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor has the sinners begging for bread. May the Lord have a meaning. Blessed on the meaning of this word. Amen. Lead me, guide me along the way. Lord, if you lead me, I shall not go astray. Lord, let me walk closer to thee. Lead me, oh Lord, lead me.
As we bow our heads in the word of prayer, dear Heavenly Fathers, we come before you as humble as we know how, with thanksgiving in our hearts. We thank you and praise you for being such an awesome God. We thank you and praise you for your darling Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for the remission of our sins, but rose on the third day with all power. Power to heal and power to forgive, we just want to say thank you this morning, O Heavenly Father. Dear Heavenly Father, we have reminded you to keep our pastors uplifted. Pastor Emeritus, the Reverend Donald McFadden Sr., and our intern pastor, the Reverend Tommy Savage Jr. Bless them, O Heavenly Father, and protect them and their families from hurt, harm, and danger. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Lord, we thank you and praise you and pray for our sick and shut-in members, O Heavenly Father. We pray for our bereaved members and our members that are lying on the bed of their affliction. We ask that you will send a healer and a comforter their way. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Lord, we thank you and praise you and pray for our children, O Heavenly Father, asking you to keep your love and arms of protection around them as they go through their highways and byways. Lord, we thank you and praise you and pray for our community, O Heavenly Father. Lord, we ask that they will put their guns down and pick up your word, O Heavenly Father. Strengthen us that we might go beyond the walls of St. Joseph, boldly proclaiming your holy name to those who don't know you as Lord and Savior. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you forgive us for our trespasses on today, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thou art the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good evening to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. It is a blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. We bring you greetings this Sunday, February 21st, and we celebrate that all that God has done in our lives, all that God has done for us.
Amen.
Here at St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church, we're just so blessed that you continue to join us and celebrate the good news of God and his plan for our lives and how he's continuing to bless us. I must admit, it is colder than it has been in a long time. And in the midst of this blizzard, in the midst of this COVID pandemic, all the craziness around us, it is just good to know that God is still in the blessing business. And every now and then, God does something just to remind us who is in control. And I saw those 18 inches of snow we got this past week, and it's certain that it's not our own doing, but that of the Lord. So we just serve an awesome and mighty God that continues to provide for us, even in the midst of these challenging times. And for those of you all that are joining us for the first time, we encourage you to look at some of the other opportunities of worship and learning that we have here at St. Joseph. And to our members and friends, we just praise God that you have taken time out your day to worship with us this morning. We have been going through our Black History series and Bible class and attempting to partner our messages with the Black History lesson. And so This week, this past Wednesday, we've looked at the history of the Black church. And so with that thing still being there, we're going to look at the 149th number of Psalms, Psalms 149. We'll read it in its entirety. I believe it speaks to exactly what we're dealing with today as a church, as a community, as a body of believers. So Psalm 149, I'll read the first and ninth verses of the entire number of Psalms. The word of the Lord reads, "Praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of saints. Let Israel rejoice in him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name in the dance. Let them sing praises unto him with the timbrel, with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hand, to execute vengeance upon the heathen, and punishments upon the meek, to bind their kings with chains, and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written. This honor have all his saints. Praise ye the Lord." Amen. For just a few moments this morning, I'm sharing with you from the subject, I still have a reason to praise.
Amen.
I still have a reason to pray. Shall we bow our heads in prayer? Heavenly Father, right now we just thank you for another day, another opportunity just to worship your name, submit our lives to your will. Father, we recognize that we have fallen short of your glory. We have made mistakes time and time again, but in your infinite wisdom and in your undeserving love, you loved us so much that you sent your son, and he loved us so much that he gave his life. And so, Father, we stand here not as sinful creatures, but as brand new vessels, washed, made whole because of the blood that your son Jesus sacrificed when he gave his life on the cross. Now, Father, as we enter into your word, help us to just clear our minds, empty out our hearts, look deep down inside each and every one of us, whatever does not belong, just plug it away, replace it with your love and your wisdom. Lift us up higher that we might see clear. Give me power and purpose and permission to preach to these your people. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Your son's name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I still have a reason to praise. In the early 1700s, in this newly formed Methodist church in England, there were two brothers that I've just become in love with, Charles and John Wesley. These were these young, fiery preachers that were just tearing churches apart, preaching a fiery new type of gospel that people had not yet heard before. And their excitement, their vigor, their energy for God was so much that the churches put them out and told them they were no longer welcome. It's literally what we get the phrase, "It doesn't take all of that." But these brothers were so on fire for Christ that they refused to be silenced because they weren't given the opportunity to stand in the church. And so they literally took their preaching to the streets, finding milk cartons and soap boxes and standing on the boxes and preaching for whoever would come and hear them. They quickly left England and made their way to the States, and then became the fathers of modern theology here in America. But their excitement was second to none. And they are most famous for the quote that if you catch on fire for God, people will come for miles to see you burn. And my brothers and sisters, the truth is that's what the church is missing right now. We're missing that excitement, we're missing that energy, and we're missing that vigor that we used to have, that old-time religion, that foot stomping, hand clapping, voice yelling religion where you would just run through the church. It didn't matter what you had on. It didn't matter how you were dressed. It didn't matter if you just got your hair done. It was the good news of God. And once it got down in your spirit, it took control to the point where you just could not help yourself. I must admit that time and time again, I like to think of myself as a little reserved, and maybe I'm not the most excited of people. But I remember one time I was at a Bulls game, and the team was down so many points, and as they began to score and march their way back, even me, thinking of myself as reserved, I just lost it. The excitement, the energy in the statement, all the points, all the dunks, all the three-pointers, it took over my soul, and I found myself jumping up and down and cheering just as loud as the person next to me. Once I realized that I am able to become excited, I started looking at other areas of my life, and I wondered how come I could get excited for a Bulls game and not for what God has done in my life. Because the Bulls game, once it's over, we go back home. But the Bulls game, even if they win or lose, it makes no effect on my life. But I serve a God that has done more for me than I could ever do for myself, that has reached down and plugged me out of obscurity, picked me up out of the sinking pit of sin, and placed me on a solid foundation. And my brothers And sisters, if we can get excited for the Bulls game, if we can get excited for the inauguration, if we can get excited for the stimulus check, if we can get excited for the vaccine, then by God, we should be excited because of all the things God has done for us. He woke us up this morning. He kept us in our right mind. He put food on our table and clothes on our back. And we serve a God that is worthy to be praised. The truth is that when we look at the condition in our churches, and it doesn't look like what it used to look like. Our pews are not as full as they used to be. Our offering buckets are not as filled as they used to be. And the truth is, we become a little discouraged. It's not as easy as it used to be. People used to come to the church just because it was there. Now we seem to be doing any and everything we can to draw people, yet our efforts seem sometimes to be in vain. But when I look at this 149th number of Psalms, I realize that David was in a very similar situation that we were in. David was going through things, and the children of Israel were going through things that they just simply didn't understand. As a matter of fact, modern theologians believe that this 149th number of Psalms was written sometime between Nehemiah and Ezra. When the children of Israel had the enemies rising up against them, when they were losing the land that God had promised them, they weren't as rich as they used to be, they weren't as respected as they used to be, they weren't as feared as they used to be. But still, the people of God found a reason to praise. As a matter of fact, the last five numbers of Psalm, 146 through 150, all begin with the words, praise you the Lord, and they all end with the words, praise you the Lord. That means that the writers of these great numbers and Psalms realize that no matter what my situation looks like, I still praise God. No matter how many enemies rise up against me, I still praise God. No matter how wealthy or poor I might be, I still praise God. And my brothers and sisters, sometimes we have to look past the conditions we find ourselves in. Sometimes we must look past the challenges of life and realize that it's not that bad, and we still got it better than we deserve, and God is still on our side. And as long as God be for us, who can be against us? There's four things I believe that this text teaches us, and we will be convinced that we still have a reason to praise. The first thing I see is that we praise God because He has called us. We praise God because He has called us. In verse 1 it says, praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and His praise in the congregation of saints. Again, these last five numbers of Psalms begin with praise the Lord, end with praise the Lord. It was an understanding that no matter what's happening in my life, I'm going to keep on praising God. And my brothers and sisters, I grew up in a home, and maybe many of us grew up in a similar situation, but we didn't really understand what was all going on. I must admit, I thought my parents were rich. I thought my parents were wealthier, and the older I got, I quickly realized that we didn't have as much as I thought we had. But the difference was, my parents kept on smiling. They kept on loving, they kept on hugging. I never saw them fight, I never saw them complain. And what it instilled in me is that no matter how strong your hand might be, no matter how weak your hand might be, you just keep on playing, and I guarantee God will work it out. I love playing spades, and every now and then I play spades. I talked about it before. I get that good hand with all spades, all face cards, all aces, and I'm ready to win and run the table. But every now and then I get a hand that's full of hearts, full of diamonds, all low cards, and I know there's no way I can win the hand. But it's in those moments that every now and then my partner says, don't worry, I got us. And he'll say, even though I have zero, he'll say, yes, 7 or 8 or 9 or 10. And we'll still win, even though I got dealt a bad hand. And what I've learned in life, it isn't so much what card you have in your hand, but it's more about the card that you have laying across the table for you. And my brothers and sisters, if your life is like mine, we haven't always been dealt the best hand. We always haven't had what we wanted. We haven't always even had what we needed. But there's a partner sitting across from us, and when we don't know which way to go, our partner takes over. When we don't know how to pay the next bill, our partner takes over. When the doctor gives us bad news, when the lawyer gives us bad news, when we don't know how to make our two ends meet, I praise God, we have a partner. God has drawn us into His salvation. He's called us into an understanding of His joy. He's called us into an understanding of His love. He's placed us in a position where we have no choice but to recognize who He is in our life. If we go on to verse 2, it says, let Israel rejoice in Him that made Him, let the children of Zion be joyful in their King. But I want to realize there's two parallels here. It shows that Israel should worship their Creator, while Zion should worship their King. And my brothers and sisters, the truth is, there's a difference between respect and reverence. I believe that there was a point in time when everyone respected the church. We talked about this past Wednesday in Bible class. There was this liberation theology movement in the late and mid-60s, during the civil rights movement. But what happened is that blacks, because we weren't allowed to go anyplace else, weren't accepted anyplace else, our natural congregating location location was the church house. Now, the church house was convenient because it was the only opportunity that we had to say what we wanted to say without fear of oppression by those forces that stood against us. Now, the problem was that everybody in the church house wasn't necessarily saved. And my brothers and sisters, it makes no sense to be that close to God, but still so far away from salvation. But I praise God that He called me into an understanding of who He is, and it wasn't because of my own self. It's because God, just like He did with Saul, knocked him off his horse, blinded his eyes, and revealed His will for his life. It was Jonah when he was fleeing from Nineveh that God caught him in the belly of a whale and made him go back and fulfill what God had for him in his life. My brothers and sisters, you cannot outrun what the Lord has in your life. And for those of us that have made mistakes, those of us that have stumbled along the way, we praise God that in spite of our mistakes, in spite of our shortcomings, in spite of our failures, God saw fit to save us because He loved us so much.
Man.
How do we see God? Do we see God different than how other people see God? My mother and father, they've accomplished a lot of things in their life. They have a lot of people that love them and respect them and speak very highly of them. No matter how much they love them, they will never love my parents more than I love my parents. Because I don't see my parents by their profession. I don't see my parents by their education. I see my parents because of the unwavering and undeniable love that they gave me. Not because I deserved it, but because they loved me so much, their creation, that it was nothing that I could do to separate myself from their love. Well, my brothers and sisters, I praise God that I got another parent. And that's God, my Father, who sits in heaven. Twice as much as my parents love me too. And because I recognize how good God is, because I recognize what He's done in my life, because I recognize how much He loves me, I respect God as my Creator, and I praise Him because He's called us. So when we're looking for this reason to praise, first thing, we praise God because He has called us. But secondly, my brothers and sisters, we praise God with all that we have. In verse 1, it says, praise the Lord, the new song, and praise Him in the congregation of the saints. And then verse 6, it says, let the high praises of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hand. It literally means that all that we have available to us should be used to praise the Lord. I didn't really realize how difficult it was to be a homeowner. I thought that you just made the purchase and didn't have to worry about it again. And then as things began to break down, as improvements needed to be made, as repairs needed to be done, I quickly realized that all the money I had coming in was going to go right back to the home. What I realized is that if I wanted to build something that was worth having, worth something that I could be proud of, something that would gain more value the longer it went, I would have to invest in it. And the more I invest in my home, the more I appreciate it. I appreciate the hard work. I respect it. I don't break things like I used to break things. This is my money that needs to fix it. I don't overlook things that I used to overlook because it's my money that's going to have to fix it. And it's built up a responsibility in me that I didn't even know I lacked. What happens is, I respect it and appreciate it so much that I then realized that if I was going to really do well by the decision of being a homeowner, that I had to put the same amount of money back into it to make it worth it. Well, my brothers and sisters, I wish we looked at our faith the way we look at some of our personal possessions. We love our car so much we'll never drive it dirty. I know women that never missed an hair and nail appointment because they care that much about their appearance. My pastor, Dr. Backus, he always has a polished pair of shoes on because his father taught him that it's respectable to always have his shoes neatly polished. And as much effort and intention that we put into these worldly possessions, the one thing that's true is no matter how much we take care of it, no matter how much upkeep we spend on it, eventually they will fade away. But my brothers and sisters, I've learned to invest in other things than physical possessions. I've learned to invest in other things than friendships and relationships with other people. I've learned to invest in my salvation and to invest in my faith. Because my faith is the one thing that will never wane. My salvation is the one thing that will stand the test of time. The gift that God has given me when He welcomed me into His saving arms is the one thing that will last when time is time no more. And so the same way I can invest in those things that I love, I recognize that I got something even better than a nice car. I got something better than a nice home. I got something better than a nice pair of shoes. I got the gift of love that God put down in my spirit. And when God gave me, can't nobody take it away. And so the same way I spend time on my home, the same way I spend time on my appearance, I've learned to spend time on my faith. And I tell you, have a little talk with Jesus. Tell Him all about your struggles. Spend some time with God, and He'll make it better by and by. God. In verse 3, the text says, let them praise his name in the dance. Let them sing praises unto him with the temple and the harp. It literally means that whatever you can find at your disposal, you should use it to praise the Lord. I wish I was a musician like Brother Spence. Every now and then I can tell when the Spirit's getting good to him. He just goes to play in a way. He uses his fingers to praise the Lord. I wish I had a voice like Deacon Franklin. When the Spirit gets good to him, he gets to singing. And you can tell how good God has been. So I wish I could pray like Deacon Wright. Because every now and then he gets into those prayers and you can tell he's thinking about just how good God has been to him. It's a reflection that comes out in his testimony. There was a man, a gospel writer by the name of Jay Moss. He said, if I was a writer, I would use my pencil. If I was a sculptor, I would use the clay. He said, if I was a piano player, I would use the keys. He said, no matter who and what you are, you deserve to give God praise. Amen. My brothers and sisters, you may not be able to preach, sing, pray, or even quote scripture word for word, but I guarantee you, God has given you something. God has blessed you with talents and abilities, and I dare you to take what God has given you and use it for his good. If you're the best chef, then I dare you to cook for Jesus Christ. If you're a cab driver, I dare you to travel for Jesus Christ. If you're a truck driver, I dare you to go on the road for Jesus Christ. If you're a dancer, put them feet to use for God. And I guarantee whatever you have, whatever God has given to you, if you just take the blessings of God and use them for his good, the world will be so much better. We need to praise God with all that we have. We praise God because he has called us. But thirdly, we praise God without ceasing. In verse 5, the text reads, let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. It kind of threw me for a loop the first time I saw this text. Because I must admit, I get lazy every now and then. I wake up in the morning, when I was young, I would get on my knees and fold my hands and pray. Now sometimes I just roll over. I don't even fold my hands. I don't close my eyes. I just start praying to the Lord. And I recognize that when I'm in my bed, it's a place of rest. It's a place of comfort. And there's not a lot of things that you can do in the bed other than rest and sleep. But my brothers and sisters, I dare you to take the place of comfort and turn your attention to the Lord. It's in the bed, and the text is a little difficult. Some people think it's the prayer bed. Some people think it's the morning bed. But what I've come to learn in my life is not really much difference. I've had times in my bed when I watched my favorite television show. I've had times in the bed when I cried tears that I never thought would dry away. I've had times in my bed when I was just so happy and excited about the good news and what God was doing in my life. What I've come to realize is no matter what mood I'm in, sometimes all I gotta do is get to my bed. My bed is the place of rest. My bed is the place of restoration. My bed is the place of comfort. It's the place where I can get back to the place that I need to be. When the text makes it clear in verse 5, it says that our place of restoration, our place of comfort, our place of rest should be the place where we commit ourselves to the Lord. And what it means is that if we're really looking for real rest, if we're looking for real restoration, if we're looking for real peace, all the sleep in the world won't fix your problems. But I guarantee you, if you establish, maintain, and grow a relationship with God, you'll find peace that you never knew existed. You'll find rest that you never knew was right there. I'm reminded of Pastor Steve Spiller. He pastors the Greater Galilee on Independence Avenue. If you ever ask Pastor Spiller how he's doing, he said, I'm doing good on a bad day and great on a good one. And it always threw me off. I thought it was just one of them old preacher sayings. The more I listened to it, the more I realized what he meant. He meant that on a bad day, when he don't have money in his pocket. He meant that on a bad day, when his health isn't that good. On a bad day, when his body is aching. On a bad day, when his relationships aren't working out the way he thinks it should. On a bad day, when his kids are acting crazy, he still has a good day. And that's because God is still with us. Amen. No matter how bad you might think your situation might be, God is still in control of your life. No matter what bad news the doctor may have given you, God is still a healer. No matter what bad news your bank account might show you, God is still a provider. Amen. When you open up your refrigerator and don't see the food that you might want to eat, we praise God that he still found something to put on our stomachs. In other words, my brothers and sisters, we may not have all that we want, but I guarantee you that we have all that we need.
Amen.
And so we need to grow to a point where we praise God without ceasing. And the way to do that is to realize that no matter what harm comes my way, God is still good. No matter what troubles find themselves in my doorstep, God is still good. No matter how bad my situation might be, God is still good. So finally, my brothers and sisters, we praise God because He has called us. We praise God with all that we have. We praise God without ceasing. But if we're looking for a reason to still praise the Lord, we praise God because of His promises.
Yeah.
In verse 4, it says, "For the Lord taketh pleasure in His people. He will beautify the meek with salvation." I remember when I was younger, all of my friends, we used to talk about when we had children. Now, I don't have children myself, but I laugh at all my friends and our parents. I remember them saying, "When I have kids, I'm never wasting money on gym shoes that they don't outgrow. When I have kids, I'm never taking them to vacations they won't remember. When I have kids, I'm not going to buy them every toy that's in the store because I'm going to be more responsible with my children." And then a few years later, when they have their kids got every pair of gym shoes that they could ever find. They got all the toys that came out in the last catalog. What happens is they love their children so much that they just can't tell them no. And whenever they look at their children, they remember how much joy and how much love they have for their child. And they just want to do more and more for them. And then if you got parents like mine, don't mess around and get a few A's on your report card. Don't mess around and do all the chores that they assigned you to do. They'll love you even twice as much, and you'll get more than what you even asked for. My brothers and sisters, God is the same way. The text makes it clear the Lord delights in His children, and He wants to see us good. God wants to see you living above the line in which you think you find yourself at. God wants to see you happy. God wants to see you peaceful. God wants to see you healthy. And I tell you, do what God has called you to do. Find a place of obedience in the Lord, and you'll see Him open out a window in heaven and pour you out blessings you won't have room enough to receive. They say the true leadership is not based on what the people you serve can do for you, but instead it's based on what you can do for the people that you serve. And the truth is, God is rich in houses and land. We can't give God enough because He already has it all. We can't pray and sing to God enough because the angels have probably got better voices than us. But my brothers and sisters, the truth is, God don't really need nothing from us. All God wants us to do is love Him and give Him the praise that He's due. And God says, if you just worship Me, if you just accept Me as your Lord and Savior, I'll in turn do everything for you. And He didn't just wake us up. He didn't just keep us in our right mind. But now, so 2,000 years ago, He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, down through 42 generations and saved the entire world by letting His Son die on the cross for our sins. And verse 6, it says, He praised Him because we are promised to pray. It says, let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. We don't have to fight the enemies of God. The truth is, all we have to do is let the word of God permeate through our lives, and God will fight our battles for us. I love hearing when I see Reverend Marvin Wiley of the Rock of Ages preach. I love hearing Dr. Wiley preach, one of the best preachers of this side of heaven. But whenever you see Dr. Wiley preach, he'll just walk into the audience. He'll walk all around the crowd, and I'm always wondering, is it safe? Is it comfortable doing that? And every now and then someone tries to get to him or interrupt him, and someone just shows up out of nowhere. It's like a security guard. What happens is Dr. Wiley is so focused on preaching, when he's obedient to the Spirit and lets the Spirit take control of the preaching moment, he's not really focused about what's going on. Every now and then he looks like he's going to miss a step. But right when he steps off the pulpit, there's somebody right there lifting their arm. What happens is, when he's doing what God has called him to do, he don't have to worry about everything else. God will provide the necessary things to get the job done. And my brothers and sisters, we can testify in our lives that when we've been obedient to God, we didn't understand how He did it. We didn't understand why He did it. We didn't understand even understand what he was going to do. But somehow, some way, God made it work. He gave us the money that we needed to do what he called us to do. He gave us the energy that he needed, that we needed to do what he called us to do. And it reminds me of the Sunday school lesson a few weeks back. When Jesus met the Samaritan woman at the well, his disciples came up and said, "Is it time to eat?" And Jesus said, "I'm not even hungry, because I've been doing what my Father has called us to do, and I'm filled in the Spirit." My brothers and sisters, I dare you to be obedient to God's will in your life. I dare you to follow the instructions that God has placed in your life and watch God make a way out of no way. Watch God be a provider. Watch God be a way maker. Watch God be a healer. In verse 9, we praise God because he defeats our enemies. The text says, to execute upon them the judgment written, this honor have all his saints. Praise ye the Lord. Exodus 14, verse 4. It says, the Lord will fight our battles if we only be silent. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Amen. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. What I've come to realize in my life is that it's good to have somebody in your corner that would fight for you. I used to watch the Chicago Bulls a lot, and they had a couple players, so I talk about them all the time. Stacey King and Cliff Levinson. They were two of my favorite players. They never really showed up much in the points column. Didn't even really get a lot of rebounds. As a matter of fact, it's kind of hard to find highlights from Stacey King and Cliff Levinson. But the one time you knew they were going to show up, it's when Michael Jordan was on the court and somebody tried to fight Michael Jordan. Mike never had to put his hands up. Mike never had to throw a punch, because the moment they picked on Mike, Stacey King and Cliff Levinson was right there on the scene. And so Mike was able to focus on the work that he was called to do, because he had two guys in his corner that was going to show up and fight his battles for him. My brothers and sisters, I know you got haters. I know you got challenges. I know you got people that don't like you. But don't worry about what the enemy is trying to destroy in your life. Don't worry about the distractions of those that sit you down, because there is a God on our side that will fight our battles, that will stand the way, that will go into the fiery furnace with us, that will burn the mouths of the lions when we find ourselves in our lion's den. But we also praise God because our future is already decided. The truth is that we know how this story is going to end. I got a lot of movies that I like to call my favorite movies. And the more I watch the movies, it's amazing to me how when the first time I watched them, I didn't know how the hero was going to make it out. I didn't know if all would be saved and never work it out in the end. But once I saw the movie the first time, it seems as if watching it the second, the third, the fourth time, all the pressure was off. No matter how bleak the situation looked, I knew how the movie was going to end. No matter how beat up the hero might have been, I knew how the movie was going to end. And so when you're going watching these movies over, it doesn't have the same amount of drama. It doesn't have the same amount of excitement. Because no matter what's on my screen, I already know it's going to work out. Well, my brothers and sisters, God gave us a promise. That one day, in the twinkling of an eye, that the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And those of us that are alive will one day meet him in the sky. And so as I go through life, when challenges find their way to my door, it's a lot less drama, because I know how the story's going to end. But I don't wake up feeling my best. I don't get down on my luck, because I know how the story's going to end. When my money is strange, and I don't know how I'm going to make ends meet, I don't let it get to me, because I already know how the story is going to end.
Amen.
Verses 1 through 4, we praise God for what he has done. But in verses 5 through 9, we praise God for what he will do. We serve a God that's never forsaken us, that's never turned his back on us. We know that through all of our trials and tribulations, that after the rain, the sun will shine. We know that for every Egypt, there's a Red Sea. We know that for every famine, there's a raven in the brook. But when we hold on to the promised future, we are sure that one day, my Savior, Jesus Christ, is coming back. It was Jesus who was washed up the hill called Calvary. It was Jesus that was placed on a cross. They put nails in his hands, and they put a stake in his feet. They hung a crown of thorns on his head, and he gave up his life that you and I might be saved. They placed our Savior in a broken We'll praise God with all that we have. We'll praise God and never cease, but we'll praise God because of the promises that's in His Word. And I don't know about you, God is true to His Word. He'll never let us down. And I'm looking forward to that day when He opens up those pearly gates and I can hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And so we hang on the promises of God because God loves us so much that He gave His Son and that His Son gave His life. Amen. We pray that someone has been encouraged this morning. Perhaps you have yet to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. Perhaps you have yet to accept the gift of salvation. But God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. And whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It's a promise. And God is true to His Word. And we can live in that promise. We can be recipients in that promise. And our future will be secured in that promise. So if by chance you have yet to make that decision to give your life to God, if by chance you are looking for a church home, please give us a call. Shoot us an email. Leave a message in the chat. And we'll be so happy to welcome you as a part of our church family. And if you're not in the Chicagoland area, if you're not close to this place, if you want to go someplace else where your needs can be met, we just care about you being saved.
Amen.
And we'll help you find a church home that can meet your needs. Or maybe you've just fallen away from the church. Maybe you've put some distance between you and God. The good news is God is still waiting with arms open wide. And all you have to do is choose this day to come back home. We pray that something has been said and done. We pray that your heart has been pricked. We pray that God has just broken into those locked doors and reveals to you just how much He loves you. For those of you that have made that choice, we praise God for you. For those of you all that are still thinking and praying about it, we ask that God just touch you like never before. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this wonderful place you brought St. Joseph. We thank you for the sacrifice that you gave when you sent your Son and when you gave His life. Father, we recognize that there are still so many of us that have yet to accept the gift of salvation, the gift that you so freely give. All we have to do is accept you as our Lord and Savior, and we too can have eternal life. So we pray that someone's heart is moved, that you have touched someone's mind, that you have broken into someone's spirit, and just let them know how much you love them and the gift of salvation that can be theirs if they only confess their sins and accept you as their Savior. We've done what we've asked, and we pray that someone responds. Your Son's name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We praise God again for each and every one of you. Thank you so much for again joining us. Just a few announcements this morning. Let's continue to make sure that we're following the PWs with our COVID pandemic. Watch your distance, wash your hands, and please wear a mask. They'll be testing next week at Greater Rock Baptist Church, Pastor Floyd James. 718 South Independence on Tuesday through Friday, next week from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Let's continue to look to our church Ruby page for updates and announcements. Sunday school is every Sunday at 10 a.m. Bible class is on Zoom every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We'll be going into our session 4 for our Black History Program, Social Justice from a Christian Perspective. Let's please continue to pray for our second shut-in list, for those that have lost loved ones. Of course, we're still praying for the Wallace family, the Wright family, so many others, the McFadden family. Let's continue to lift up all of our members that are struggling with loss. Let's be an encouragement to them and continue to be a support system, because that's what our church family is for. Let's continue to pray for our pastor Maris, for Don McFadden Senior's entire family, our church membership, our church leadership, our pastoral search process, and all of our members and friends. For those of you all that like to worship and giving, we have three ways to give here at St. Joseph. You can use our website, stjosephmbchurch.com, as a giving tab. You can mail your check or money orders to the church, St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church, 2901 West Monroe Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60612. Or give to Deacon Franklin a call, 312-219-0215. Our chairman will make arrangements for someone to pick up their gift. God has given us all that we have. He only asks for 10% back. And then we also have other ministries that remember to support our Sunday school giving and the other work that we're doing here at the church. God has been good to us, and God is a keeper. And I believe that God blesses the friendly giver.
Amen.
And so the more we give to God, the more He gives to us. And one thing I've learned in my life, you can't be God's giver, no matter how hard you try. So those of you all that consider giving, we praise God for your sacrifice and for your commitment to the Lord, through worship and giving. If nothing else, we praise God again for each and every one of you. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you this Wednesday night, 7 p.m. in Bible class, that Sunday, 10 a.m. for Sunday school, and then 11 a.m. for our worship service. If nothing else, let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Father, we've entered into this place to worship, but we ask it to serve. So equip us with the tools necessary to be obedient to your will in our life. Father, help us to recognize no matter how difficult life might get, no matter how challenging the times might be, that we still have plenty of reasons to praise you, Father. You're such an awesome and a great God, so we worship your name this morning, and we praise you for all that you have, are, and will continue to do in our lives. As we leave this place, Father, just equip us with all that's necessary to do your will. Help us to be lights in the midst of darkness, that others might run, come running, ask what they can do to be saved. And we be careful that all of the good things that we do, it be for your glory and your glory alone. Now unto him who is able to present us faultless before the presence of his Lord, with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our King, be both glory and majesty, but have dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the people of God says together, Amen. Amen. God bless you. We love you. There's nothing you can do about it. Have a great day.